Hypernix speeds require high flow hotends, and those require an extruder that is capable of forcing all that filament through a tiny nozzle. So having big filament drive gears is beneficial to better grip it and prevent it from slip and deformation. The only issue with those is that we're losing a lot of leverage and the extruder stepper needs more torque. This is where gearing ratios comes in. By using a higher ratio, we can achieve greater torque. But as with everything in life, there's always downsides. Mainly how much you are reducing the ratio, that much faster the stepper motor must be capable of accelerating and rotating. And when you reduce the ratio to an insane 20 times, it raises a question: is it actually stupid or just doesn't matter? Especially as one of the most praised Arbiter V2 extruders uses a way lower gearing ratio and almost nobody in 3D printing market uses those high ratios. So I went on a testing quest to dig deeper, because surely it has to be something. It can't be nothing. All this started when Anker sent this M5C to check out. The build quality was nice, but I couldn't say the same about the prints, as those were plagued with ghosting artifacts. However, it had something very unique, and it was the 21.6:1 ratio extruder with big filament drive gears. At first, that seemed just like a marketing trick, because bigger number equals more better, right? But flow rates were great, so I thought why not to test it how it will perform when an extruder is pushed to the limit. Will it fail at high speeds and excels? Because stepper motors are not that capable speed-wise, and it is so much higher reduction ratio than we see on other extruders. So to test that, I designed a simple print that has deceleration, details and acceleration sections. But I have to compare prints to something, and the closest printer performance-wise that I had was fully modded KP3S. Both have similar flow hotends, big filament drive gears and similar sized beds, but most importantly twice the difference in extruders gearing ratios. The only issue, that M5C doesn't run clipper and doesn't have linear rails for the most apples-to-apples comparison. And because I'm kinda clueless when it comes to hacking stuff, I reached out to people from AnchorMake. Honestly, I had no hopes for this project to move forward. However, their engineers not only provided the required files for the clipper, but also helped troubleshoot problems and shared their created config for the M5C, as turns out they were already cooking something and had plans with it. But I can't share any of the details, and you should wait for the official AnchorMake team announcement. So now with clipper running on the BTT Pi neatly attached inside, what's left was the easy part, making the linear rail conversion. And I say easy because once again Anker even shared their 3D printer step files on their Discord so people could make all kinds of accessories. That makes designing a drop-in replacement so easy. Well, no pun intended, but as easy as ordering the parts from today's video sponsor PCBWay. They manufactured these parts for the project, so huge thanks to them. This allows me to make a very straightforward conversion that wouldn't be possible otherwise. But nothing is sunshine and roses. Meanwhile, drilling and tapping holes into the aluminum frame is a pretty easy task. Aligning four carriages was an impossible one. They added so much drag and input chamber results were just atrocious. I ended up using only two carriages, which gave a significant improvement in reducing overall vibrations. And if you are interested, here are the input shaping results for the X-axis, which were even more impressive as M5C's toolhead is on a heavy side. All that can be directly seen in the ghosting tower test prints. Plus, even two small carriages gave a better stiffness to the bed, and first layer consistency was noticeably better. Well then, finally we can test it. Keep in mind that both machines were fully tuned with input shaping, rotation distance, flow rates and pressure vents, and even settings like bed mesh fading were reduced to avoid the possible bottleneck. At a slow 1000 mm/s² printing acceleration, we can establish a baseline on how prints look like, and there was almost no difference apart from most moving on the smaller portions of a print. At 5k acceleration, story was the same with almost identical results. Maybe 10k will make a difference. Nope, the results were still the same. Surely then 20k will do the trick. Nope. Both prints still look identical with no extrusion problems. Okay, so 30k next. No way it will be possible, right? But again, it's still printed perfectly fine. But why? Well, obviously because we're not reaching the limit of a stepper, but that is such a boring answer, so I made some calculations. Let's see what affects our extrusion system. First, the force needed to extrude. I chose extruding at 24 cubic millimeters per second, and to get a somewhat realistic needed force value, I'll calculate it from the Orbitus project website graphs. Next, the peak torque required for the motor during acceleration. The reason why we'll be calculating all the peak values is that during acceleration the required peak torque of a stepper will be highest when reaching the set speed where extruding requires the most force. I also made a few slow motion shots to determine what a reasonable extruding acceleration would be, and with pressure advance enabled it was very similar to 2500 mm per second squared, more on this later. However, because we're using such high reductions, our accel on the motor will be 10 and 20 times higher. The main three things that affects the acceleration are the inertia of a stepper's rotor, the inertia of a load, and the gearing reduction. The most interesting thing here is that gearing ratios reduce load inertia squared, meaning with a twice higher ratio we get 4 times lower load inertia. So in a scenario where we have a significant required extrusion force, a higher ratio extruder will require less torque during acceleration. And when we combine the peak acceleration torque with the peak extrusion torque, we get that a 20:1 ratio extruder stepper requires a significantly lower total peak torque. But we need to reach twice the speed, and in this scenario it will be around 210 rpm for the 20:1 ratio and 105 for the 10:1 ratio using 18mm filament drive gears. Now we need to find a similar size stepper motor's torque curve and put those values in a graph. For simplicity's sake, the graph shows the peak required torque during the whole acceleration period, and when we reach a constant speed the torque drops as we're no longer accelerating. So despite the 20:1 ratio extruder needing to rotate twice as fast, at those RPMs stepper's torque is still very high and there won't be any issues in this scenario. In theory, it could do up to 11 kg of extruding force. Not that you would need so much, as at that point you're probably just not melting the plastic, but rather deforming it into a string. But enough of all the calculations. I also printed the same file on Bamboo Labs X1C and Corralitis K1, and the extrusion results were basically the same compared to the M5C. After seeing this, I pushed the high ratio extruder even further by printing at 500 mm per second, but I didn't see any signs of failing extrusion. But this is where things took to a more interesting route. Clipper uses pressure advance, which is mostly known for reducing bulging on the corners of the prints. But what it also does, it gives a more smooth extruder's motion, meaning it is extremely hard for the extruder's motor to skip steps and fail to extrude. So without pressure advance, we should get the best case scenario where the extruder could skip steps. And immediately the first print at 30 kxls looked extremely under extruded at the acceleration section. But the problem was that I never heard stepper motor skipping steps, and even using slow printing acceleration of 1K under extrusion looked almost identical. But why? Well, because molten plastic doesn't react in a linear way inside a hot end. There's always some delay as you have to build up pressure or lower depending if you are accelerating or decelerating in the print. So this is just not having enough pressure in the hot end to extrude the required amount of plastic at high accels and speeds, and has nothing to do with extruder's ratio. And if we look at how the extruder accelerates in slow motion with pressure advance and without, we can see that it takes full control of acceleration and smooths it quite a bit and comes nowhere even close to the maximum possible extruder's acceleration on this printer. So are high ratio extruders stupid? And the short answer is no. If a stepper motor is capable of achieving enough torque and high speeds, then they seem perfectly fine if you need that extra filament pushing force. Combined with big filament driving gears that have amazing grip with low filament deformation, it can be a great choice. There's always be other factors like longevity or noise, but in general I don't see them not being viable. But maybe you do, feel free to share your opinion with explanation. Huge thanks to people who follow and like the videos, and huge thanks to all the Patreon and YouTube supporters. If you want to contribute to my testing and get testing data sooner plus things that didn't make into a video, consider supporting my work on Patreon. Well, that's all from me, and I'll see you next time.